for Daily Dose, presented by FanDuel. For that, we say hi and hello to Rob Reese. Rob, let's start on the waiver wire, my favorite place, and talk about some must-add players there.
All right, three players that could win your championship. Let's start with David Perron, St. Louis Blues. Left wing, right wing, 33% owned. He's got 16 straight games with a point. That breaks down to 21 points, 9 goals, 12 assists, plus 11 rating, 4 power play points, and 41 shots on goal over that span. That's a must-add player. He's skating on an underrated second line with Jaden Schwartz and Oscar Sundquist, two players in the NHL.com ranking top 200 players. If Perron's not available, get Schwartz, left wing, 29% owned. For my defenseman, I like Dmitry Orlov for the Washington Capitals. He's 17% owned. He's got 7 assists, a plus 9 rating, 13 shots on goal, 22 hits, 11 blocks in his past 8 games. And it looks like the Caps might be without Michael Kempney for a few games. He was injured last night, so look for Orlov to see some elevated ice time. The Caps have 6 20-goal scorers on the roster. Could be 7 if Backstrom gets there, so definitely get Orlov to get that exposure. My goalie, Malcolm Subban, Vegas Golden Knights, 7% owned. He's got back-to-back wins with Fleury out day-to-day with a lower body injury. Subban 6-2-0 in the past 8 with a .914 save percentage. I picked up Subban today. Hope I at least get 2 starts from him. He's going tonight against Winnipeg, so that could be 3 straight Ws. At this time of year, you need a player like that on your fantasy team.
All right, for our daily players, let's talk value. Show me the money, Rob Reese.
All right, we're hot in daily fantasy. So let's start off with Ryan Johansson, the center for the Nashville Predators. He's $5,800 versus the Pittsburgh Penguins. He's got 6 assists in a 5-game point streak right now, skating 19 minutes per game over the span with 4 shots on goal. That's cheap exposure to 2 of the hottest wings in the NHL right now, Vic Arvidsson and Philip Forsberg. They both have nice production. Arvidsson 7 points in the past 6, Forsberg 7 in the past 7. That's a player you've got to have in your lineup for exposure. My wing, Jonathan Huberdeau, Florida Panthers, $7,500, so get out the wallet here versus the Arizona Coyotes. Since February 17th, though, he ranks 2nd in the NHL with 27 points. That's 10 goals, 17 assists in 17 games. His line mate, Alexander Barkov, has 32 points, 13 goals, 19 assists, and 51 shots on goal over that same span. That's 1st in the NHL. Get out the wallet. Get those guys in your lineup. My defenseman, Dougie Hamilton, Carolina Hurricanes, saving some money here, $5,800 versus the Tampa Bay Lightning. He's got 4 points and 22 shots on goal in his past 6 games. Top pairing with Slavin at even strength, so you got that Sebastian Aho exposure. And they're facing a Tampa team that had 58 shots on goal against against the Caps last night, and they took 34 hits, so that might be a depleted team tonight. My goalie, I love Mike Smith tonight, $8,000 versus the Ottawa Senators. He's confirmed to start. Pay very close attention to this Flames team down the stretch. Both goaltenders are auditioning for the playoff starting job. Mike Smith's 3 straight losses, I don't love the sound of that, but he won 5 straight prior. So the new winning streak for him starts tonight against the Ottawa Senators. Mark that down right now. My sleeper, Dylan Sekera, Chicago Blackhawks, $3,200, super cheap versus the Philadelphia Flyers. He's expected to skate on the top line with Jonathan Toews and Patrick Kane. He's got 0 goals in his NHL career, but he has 13 shots on goal in the past 3 games, so I'm willing to wager that changes tonight.
All right, I like those picks, Rob. You're always on the money. As they say, good luck to you and good luck to anyone taking Rob's advice in daily fantasy tonight. By the way, you can find Rob on the Fantasy on Ice podcast everywhere that podcasts are streamed. And you can play fantasy hockey all season long at FanDuel.com/NHL for your chance to win nightly cash prizes or a free subscription to NHL.tv. Kucherov just continuing to look like the Hart Trophy candidate that he is.
Oh, yeah, he's been the man this year. He's been terrific. And this is the really nice goal that the Lightning scored in the power play. And we're just going to break it down because it's going to go. They think they got out of the zone there, Niskanen, but he loses the puck. And how quick it goes from Stamkos to point to Palat. Bang, bang, bang. Now, this is a tough spot, Weeksy. He doesn't have much to shoot with here. So look at this. This is how good they are. A little drop to Stamkos, who gets to the spot. It looks like it's all walled off. No way to get that puck over to Kucherov. I beg to differ, because he's going to be able to slide it through, and then Kucherov puts it in the net. I think that play from when Stamkos first touches it, it's going to take about like 5 seconds, maybe less than that, and just a terrific work by the Tampa Bay Lightning, and you can see Kucherov, yeah, baby, puts it in the net. So, Weeksy, this team, You don't want to give them opportunities because they don't need much time to put it in the net.
You're absolutely. That was an absolute clinic by Tampa.
Yes, it was.
Power play set up in the O-zone straight off the faceoff. You couldn't have drawn it up much better than that. But Nikita Kucherov, I said it last week on this show, give him the Hart Trophy. It's got his name on it. He will be receiving that out in Vegas as the NHL's most valuable player at the NHL Awards in Las Vegas. No question, it's a wrap. He's been dominant.
He certainly has, and we've been monitoring, just for fun, the race between Cooch and his own team. Like, who's going to finish with more points, right?
Right, exactly.
Well, they both got a couple of points last night, as we just saw on the board. So only 1 point separates the Cooch man from the Tampa. I mean, it's anybody's race. Like, will it be Cooch? Will it be Tampa? Nobody knows.
That's incredible.
And it's a good thing. It's a fun thing to follow.
Totally.
So what did we say when we made our predictions?
I thought the team would end up with more points, but I'm starting to change my opinion.
They have a chance at 2 points every night. That's the probability.
Yeah. But so does he, the way he's playing.
Well, I mean, he's got a chance at 4 or 5 points tonight,
but
apparently.
But I mean, on an average, because you know, you look at his point per game average. I mean, it trends closer to 2. It's crazy.
Yeah.
It's like video game. It's NHL. NHL 2018 or 2019, whatever it is for him.
Well, as
video game mode all year.
Yeah, he certainly has. Mark Scheifele, also a part of that club. He records 80 points for the second time in his last 3 seasons with the Jets. My question for you, is Mark Scheifele underrated? Because I feel like he kind of is.
Well, we talked about it last year, right? We see during the playoffs when he was playing well and Jets made it to the conference final. We talked a lot about him. And I think as he continues to put up these numbers and continues to produce in the postseason, he will get more and more attention. But you're right, Jackie. I guess he plays
just
in Winnipeg.
Slightly.
It's off the map a little bit here in the U.S. And, you know, that's probably a fair estimate. But look at the numbers. Just getting better and better and better.
Yeah, career high in goals. And Mark Scheifele, he learned so much playing in junior hockey for the great Dale Hawerchuk, playing up in Barrie in the OHL. He had a big impact in his development, the way he sees the game, the way he approaches the game, a lot of the professional knowledge that he was able to pass along as a high-end offensive player. Dale Hawerchuk certainly helped him, but from everybody I talked to in Winnipeg, they say that this guy is a consummate professional. Each and every day, on and off the ice, he does everything to be a better player and to be a great player. He's ascended. What a player he is. He's one of the best players in the National Hockey League. So, yes, he is underrated in my book, for sure.
Yeah, one of my favorite quotes from him, I believe it was this season, was, "There is not a waking moment where I am not thinking about hockey."
Yes.
Yeah, and it looks like it.
I love hockey
nerds.
Because
he just put so much work.
I love fellow hockey
nerds. He is one. I think he is one.
I'm one of them myself. Hey, listen, it's not, you know, for a lot of the young girls and boys that play out there, this is it.
Yeah.
Like, this is what you know, we have these conversations.
Yeah.
This is a big part of it. You got to eat, sleep, and breathe the game. You got to really be immersed in the game all the time. And I think that the players, be it Crosby, be it Lundqvist, all the players we talk about, Patrick Kane,
all the best.
No accident.
It's no accident.
No.
Austin Matthews was skating with those guys, Jane Doan and them, since he was 14 years old in the summers.
Yeah.
If you were, I know you know. So that's, he's just like, yep, I got you. But
I remember.
But that's a big part of it, though, right?
Yes.
You got to give them credit for that.
Yeah.
So
it's true.
It's a big takeaway for the young girls and boys that play the game.
Thanks for joining me for a walk back into hockey's historic past on NHL Now. This week, a blink and you'll miss it scoring record, the Art Ross Trophy of 60 years ago, 2 goaltending feats of significance, and a photo to close the week offered just because it's a great photo. On March 23, 1952, Bill Mozienko of the Chicago Blackhawks set an NHL record for the fastest 3 goals by 1 player, scoring a hat trick in just 21 seconds. Mozienko beat Rangers goalie Lorne Anderson for the 3rd period natural hat trick. On March 22, 1959, Dickie Moore of the Montreal Canadiens set an NHL record for most points in a season, reaching 96 with a goal and an assist in a 4-2 win at New York. With 41 goals and 55 assists, Moore won his 2nd consecutive Art Ross Trophy as the NHL's leading point scorer, his 96 points breaking by 1, Gordie Howe's record of 95 set in 1952-53. On March 26, 1963, Toronto's Johnny Bower became the first Maple Leafs goaltender to earn an assist in a Stanley Cup playoff game. The China Wall, as Johnny was known, picked up a helper on Bob Pulford's goal in a 3-1 win over Montreal in Game 1 of the Stanley Cup semifinals. The Maple Leafs would repeat as Cup winners in 1963, winning their 3rd straight in 1964 as well. On March 26, 1970, Chicago rookie goalie Tony Esposito broke Harry Lumley's 16-year-old modern NHL record of 13 shutouts in a season. Tony owes 14th of 15 shutouts that year, which would earn him the Calder Trophy as the NHL's Rookie of the Year, led the Blackhawks to a 1-0 win over the Red Wings at Detroit. And for our great photo, on March 21st, 1939, Montreal's Claude Bourque became the third rookie goalie in NHL history to earn a shutout in his first career playoff game. I love this shot of Bourque because of his cricket-style goalie pads, elbow pads worn outside his wool sweater, and gloves that quite honestly look like oven mitts. Good luck to your favorite team if they're battling down the home stretch for a berth in the Stanley Cup playoffs. If they are, here's hoping their goalie will stand at least as tall as Claude Bourque's gray hair.
Yeah, it's that time of year. Former Buffalo Sabre Chris Drury, who played 12 seasons in the NHL and who is now the assistant GM of the New York Rangers, has been named the GM of Team USA for next month's World Junior Championships. He joins the show now.
Yeah.
Thanks for your time, Chris. We appreciate it. Congrats on the gig.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, guys. And, the World Championships, right? Not the juniors.
That's oh, right. Yeah. Did I say World right. Junior? Just rolls off the tongue sometimes.
Yes. Yeah. Maybe you'll do both. Maybe you'll do both. You never know.
Depends on how he performs in this one. Right? Drew, Weeksy here. What's up, man? It was great seeing you the other night, but come on. We're talking about this off camera. I mean, what happened? We saw you the other night, post game in the Garden, Big Daddy and I. We thought you would have come over and given it, but no, nonetheless, congrats on that.
He's looking for a scoop.
Yeah, that's
what you were doing.
I know. He jammed me up on that already. But take us inside this process for you and what this is going to entail now coming down the stretch here with the remainder of the season in the AHL and the NHL and how you're going to balance that with your responsibilities for Team USA.
I'm just very excited, obviously. You know, it's a huge honor anytime your country asks you to participate, you know, for a big tournament like this. I'm just really excited. You know, when I got the official call from John Van Beesbrouck, was certainly excited and humbled and thrilled to be part of it. You know, I've already kind of hit the ground running, you know, a few days ago, trying to get lists together and talk to a lot of different people and certainly have a lot of people to lean on and with the GM committee that, I get to work with and, you know, looking forward to get going.
Now, is that really just what happens here? Because obviously you're going to look and see about the teams that are not going to qualify for the postseason. That's the first priority. Look for the American-born players that are on those teams. Is that what you do? Reach out maybe to those general managers and people around the team and you try to get information and see which guys would be willing to make the trip?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's kind of already been started at least a month ago. I think the GM started getting together. Talking about this to the GMs, the American GMs, I mean, the ball's kind of rolling a little bit. And, as teams do get eliminated or teams that are eliminated, you know, we meet every week and kind of figure out who we're going to go after. And I'm sure you guys know what the tournament is a week later this year. So there's a little more time than in years past to figure things out.
Drew Weeksy, I know that you're a proud graduate of college hockey, a lot of great college hockey players across the nation. Are you looking at some of those players, perhaps a guy like even Quinn Hughes has now gone to the Canucks out of University of Michigan, but are you looking and scouring the college hockey ranks to see if anybody kind of jumps out at you as well?
Yeah, I think if it's the right player and it's the right fit, certainly I wouldn't cross anyone off because they're in college or just out of college. You know, I was fortunate enough to go as a college player twice in my career, and you know, I always think back to Jim Johansson, what a great job he did. And, you know, he kind of always looked at it that it was, you know, his responsibility and this team's responsibility to, you know, bring the next generation along and show them how it is. And even if, they're not going to play a key role, you know, they're getting to practice with NHL players and you know, be on the road for 3 weeks with NHL players. And, you know, that's never a bad thing.
Hey, Chris, I want to ask you about the New York Rangers. You're the assistant GM. You're working for Jeff Gorton there. How do you feel this rebuild is going? I mean, it's been probably about 14 months now since last season. You guys put the letter out. We're going to rebuild. You've made a lot of moves. Where do you think this group is at?
Well, I think it's been pretty good. You know, I know at times it's hard on the players, and we obviously had to trade a lot of really good players and a lot of really good Rangers. So, and I think at times, the staff and the players are kind of looking around, and it's not the easiest, but I think for what we set out to do and, you know, the course we set for the organization has been pretty good in the last 14 months. You know, if you look at our depth charts and our prospect chart, look at it, you know, 18 months ago and look at it today, it's certainly, you know, a different look. And, you know, we're excited about the players that we've gotten on a trade or through the draft and, players that we're going to draft, come June in Vancouver with all these picks.
Some of those aforementioned players that you would know from your time in Hartford, of course, be it Hájek, be it Hedl, making a big difference. Howden has been in the lineup. Georgiev has been very impressive. But what about a guy like your first rounder last year, Kravtsov? Where does things stand with him? I talked to one of my friends who's coaching over in Russia. He was very impressed with his game this year. Is there a chance that he could join the Rangers down the stretch?
I don't think down the stretch, no. I think, we're going to look to get him in after the season is over. You know, I don't think there's any rush or any reason to force him in down the stretch here. I think Jeff would say the same thing. So, we're looking forward to getting him over here as soon as we can when his contract runs out in Russia. Hopefully he's going to have a big summer of training and hit the ground running come training camp in September.
Chris, Mark Parrish was on the air last night when this announcement came out, and he was very complimentary of you. Do you have any Mark Parrish stories you'd like to share?
We were fortunate enough to play together a few different times. He's always a great teammate and a great guy. So I didn't know that he'd done that, but I appreciate it and give my best.
Dinner on him.
There you go.
Free steak for you in the city right there.
Yeah, I like that. I like that. Hey, Chris, let me ask you about, you're in this, you're taking the steps. I mean, we've seen this before with former players. You get into management, then you move up the ladder. You're an assistant GM. Now you're going to be a GM for Team USA at the World Championships, and that's just another kind of check, I think, as you move forward in your career. I would imagine that somewhere down the road you'd like to be a general manager.
Yeah, I would be. I'm not going to lie to you guys and say that I wouldn't be, but there's a lot of people, I'm sure, that would give you that same straight answer. But, at the moment, I absolutely love where I'm working. I couldn't have a better boss than Jeff Gordon. There's not a day goes by where I'm not asking him something or learning something. And I'm getting to see a lot of different things, which has been great, and certainly excited to do it for the team I grew up rooting for and kind of in the region that I grew up living in. And I just hope to keep helping with this rebuild every step of the way.
All right, well, Chris, thanks for the time again. Yeah. And congratulations on the gig with Team USA for the World Championship.
Yes, the big guy.
Yes, appreciate the time and good luck.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Have a good day.
About knocking on Kevin's door on NHL Now, but we're going to do things a little differently this time. We're going to look at goaltending tandems, because this season we've got quite a few weeks, see, that are just getting things done.
Yes.
And we should start, I think, with those Carolina Hurricanes that EJ was just talking about with Mike.
Yeah, of course. Peter Mrazek and Curtis McIlhenny, two very different paths. I had the chance to speak to Jeff Selyanko, who is the goalie coach of the Detroit Red Wings, who was raving about Peter Mrazek's transformation this year, the maturation in his approach, his work habits, and they need to be there. And for Curtis McIlhenny, a guy that's exceeded every expectation, hasn't been handed anything in his NHL career, has had to scratch and claw, but it's made for a nice tandem. They both have been very consistent and at times spectacular all season long. Curtis McIlhenny with a great start. Peter Mrazek has been tremendous down the stretch, but there's a lot that they can lean on in this tandem. They've been outstanding for Rod Brind'Amour and the Caniacs down in North Carolina.
And what a story the Canes have been, huh?
Amazing story.
I mean,
so happy to see
so
it.
So much fun to watch. I can't wait to see what they do in the playoffs with those Sellies.
Absolutely.
Because if they do it in the playoffs, I'm going to give them respect just for having the guts
to do it
in the postseason.
Absolutely.
Elsewhere, the Boston Bruins look unstoppable, and their goaltending tandem has been spectacular as well.
You're right. And you know what? Going back to the offseason, when I heard that Jiro Halak was going to sign there, I was like, wow. That's big, and I know him and Zdeno Chara are boys. They played together internationally, but he's been so steady for them, and Tuukka Rask has been great as well. I mean, Tuukka Rask is an elite goalie. This is one of the top goalies in the league, but Jiro Halak has had a very good career. He's playing. I love his slot right now because he's not overplaying, but he's been a number one for so long, but he can platoon in this situation. He could be an outstanding number two that plays like a one. And then in the case of Tuukka Rask, just so smooth and efficient and fluid in the net. Hey, the fans in Beantown have themselves a really good team and a great goalie duo here.
That is a cup-contending team.
100%.
For sure. We talk 100%. About the Canes and how great a story they are. Yes. How about the New York Islanders?
Oh,
we've been asking for goaltending on Long Island forever.
Yeah, exactly.
They got it.
They got it. But, hey, I got to start out with Lou Lamoriello and Coach Trotz and the staff, Johnny Gruden, Mitch Korn, Piero Greco, their goalie coach. I mean, this staff is class, and they've really helped transform the New York Islanders. They've done an outstanding job of resetting the culture and elevating the level of professionalism. But Thomas Greiss, as we talked about, our international players, and Robin Leonard, same thing, international player out of Sweden, Greiss out of Germany, both have been excellent all season long. I think that they've exceeded the external expectations, but they've really, really carried this team, and the defensive zone structure has been outstanding under Barry Trotz. Best in the league goals against.
And both of those goaltenders will tell you that, too. I can't remember which one said this earlier in the season, but they said, you know, last year it was like so many different options.
No question.
And it's a lot less to think about
Absolutely.
And manage as a goaltender for them now. In Tampa, you might think Vazzy's the only goaltender getting things done. Not true. Louis Domingue showing up as well.
Yeah, Louis Luai has been great for them. I got to say, you know, I saw some of the talent when he was in Arizona, but the maturity wasn't quite there. The overall approach wasn't quite there. But, hey, listen, France Jean, their goalie guru down in Tampa, has brought him into the fold and said, hey, you see this guy here, the big cat, Vasilevsky? You see how hard he works? You see how hard he trains? You see his body? You see his work ethic? Just go ahead and photocopy that, please. And that's what he's done. He's really learned a lot, I believe, from being around Vasilevsky. And Louis Domingue has really, really improved this season. Vasilevsky, the big cat, franchise record, 54 saves. Bishop was amazing as a goalie there. Nikolai Habibulin was amazing as a goalie there. They now have another one right there. Look at the eyes. You see the intensity, Jack?
Oh, wow. Yeah.
That's where you know he's dialed
in. Good point by you.
That's where you know he's dialed in. 100%. Great performance last night, but great duo as well.
You mentioned the former Bolt, Ben Bishop. He's going to be part of our next tandem out in Dallas. Anton Hudobin and Ben Bishop.
Ben Bishop also should be in the Vezina Trophy. I'm looking at defense. Vezina Trophy conversation because along with Vasilevsky and Marc-Andre Fleury, I think that that's the trio. They've been dynamic. Freddie Anderson is going to get honorable mention. But this looks like the Ben Bishop we saw in Tampa. And I would be in poor form if I didn't mention Jeff Reese. I think Jeff Reese has been able to get the best out of Ben Bishop again. He looks like himself. Franchise record shutout streak. And, of course,
Eddie Belfour, of all people.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Amazing. And, of course, Anton Khudobin. Khudoba has been sweet. He's been sweet for them. Really, really nice for the Dallas Stars. Jim Montgomery, their head coach, has done a nice job keeping this team together through some adversity earlier in the season. And I like the way the Stars are trending. But the goaltending for them on a night-to-night basis, top shelf.
Oh! Oh, my God! Oh! 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 That got me hype! Oh! Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
No!
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
Thank you.
That's
so wrong.
Oh, sweat it out with Kevin Weeks.
It's so wrong.
First of all, kudos to Jamie Hirsch, always a good teammate with the assist
opening
montage.
Thanks so much, Hirsch.
For anyone watching, it can get a little hot.
Be honest. Come on.
Well, not usually. It's freezing in here.
Normally it's freezing
because it can.
Heated up, right? He gets excited. Yeah. So we're going to do a new segment called Sweating It Out with Kevin Weeks.
Yeah. When the temperature inches above like 50, he does start to perspire.
There's a reason I always have sleeves when K-Dub is on the show because I know it's going to be cold in here.
Try a park.
Brisk.
Crying out loud. Brisk. Yeah. You know what? I will say it keeps you on your toes.
Keeps you on your toes.
I will say that.
We can't pretend we're in front of the fireplace at home. You know what I mean? Each. Seriously, we can.
So, every once in a while, we catch Weeksy sweating it out on set. So we thought we would apply that to the playoff push in the NHL.
Fan 590.
So we'll start in the Eastern Conference as Weeksy gets his personal fan out.
Is that an electric shape?
And we'll talk with the Columbus Blue Jackets, who are sweating it out with 84 points, desperately trying to hold on to that final wild card spot in the East after making all the moves at the trade deadline.
Yes, the Jackets have a lot of pieces and a lot of really good pieces. I've got to say, Atkinson's had a tremendous year, back to the All-Star game once again. Bobrovsky coming off an amazing shutout. That one, 46 saves, a couple starts back. But then you bring in Dzingel, you bring in Duchesne, Boone Jenner coming off a hat trick. The bread man, though, is the key. That is the one key.
And he's not producing, like, not a lot of bread.
No, there's not as much bread. It's not
one goal in 15 games.
It's not rising to say the yeast isn't there, but I love the fight, bro. The fight each.
Well,
that fight was incredible.
That was a nice fight, but you don't get 2 points for that fight.
That's fair, but they're sweating it out right now. I like their team. I love the pieces, but they're sweating it out right now. They're trying to get in.
Torch is sweating it out.
Oh, yeah.
They have some winnable games on that sked, though, that
strength
we just looked at, right?
About,
like, yes, there's three teams on there that are currently in a playoff spot.
Got to win tonight.
The rest, well, yeah.
Because, you know, the Edmonton Oilers came into Columbus
And they fired the cannon right at the Blue Jackets. And so they got to return that favor tonight and beat them. They shut them out 4-0 in their building.
That is true.
So you got to get even tonight and win that game.
Well, you talk about Montreal. It's the team we're going to talk about next.
Yes.
Right on the heels of those Jackets outside the playoff picture, but just 1 point back. So very much within striking distance.
Very much within striking distance. And Carey Price has been money. He's back to being healthy. He looks like himself. Tremendous season. Drouin had an amazing start with Max Domi. Not quite the same level of production, but this guy right here, Brandon Gallagher, has been amazing for them. North of 30 goals. A happy and healthy Shea Weber back. He's been dominant. Petrie quietly played very well for them all season, EJ.
Yes, he has.
But all that's very under. But all that's moot.
If there's moot.
The point is moot. If there's no Stanley Cup playoffs up in Montreal in April.
That's correct,
right?
Hey, March 28th is the big showdown. The Blue Jackets and Canadians in Columbus.
Oof.
And
what game is that? Where is that in terms of like how many games are left at that point?
It'll be like, I guess, five for each, because when you look at the sheet here, they got five more for the Jackets after that, four more for the Habs. And the Habs finished the season at home against the Leafs.
Wow.
Who would probably love nothing more.
Yeah, than to, exactly.
To push them down a flight of stairs.
You mentioned that earlier, Eats.
Yes.
Yeah, you were talking about that.
Well, I'm from Jersey. That's where we handle things sometimes. Yeah, there you go. See ya. Down you go. But and the Jackets. You like that, huh? The Jackets. They can finish out on the road, but at the Rangers and at that. Oh, thank you.
I told you.
It's nice.
A little warm. It's all fun and games until you need it.
And that's true.
Yeah.
At the Rangers and at the Senators. And that could be interesting for the Jackets, right?
Yeah.
To go to Ottawa, of all places, where Duchesne and Dezingle came from.
True.
In those trades and then have to win there. So it's going to be a wild finish with those two teams. They are.
Sweating it out.
Oh,
yes, they are. Let's turn our attention over to the Western Conference and see who's sweating it out in the West as we take a look at the wild card standings. The Stars and Yotes of all teams holding down the wild card positions in the West. So let's hone in on the Minnesota Wild because they are certainly sweating it out. Weird team.
A lot of panic out there in the land of 10,000 lakes. I tell Jackie that all the time. A lot of panic. Yeah, very weird because they seem to be the same team every year. They have some nice pieces, but there's no major progression. There's no major steps forward. There's no major elevation.
They have plateaued.
They're very much in and around the same. Now, I will say this. The injury to Matt Dumba has really hurt them. Matt Dumba was off to a torching start for them.
And Koivu.
Yes, of course. Absolutely.
Number one center top pair defenseman. I mean, it's hard to lose guys like that. Look at this schedule, though. This is a disaster.
Yeah.
Good luck.
You talk about sweating. The Washington Capitals.
Jamie Hurt just sweating it out looking at that graphic.
Yeah. So good. The Capitals.
The Wild high school tournament, the hockey hair, I don't know. Right. Come on, James.
Come on. We got the Capitals and the Hurricanes on the road back-to-back. Good luck. And then afterwards, Nashville, Vegas, Arizona, Winnipeg, Boston, at Dallas.
That's tough.
They're done.
And they've lost five of their last six, so they haven't done themselves any favors.
I'll be shocked.
Again, I keep saying the biggest thing for them, you need to have that composure, and there seems to be a lot of panic. We can respect the passion in that great market, but there's a lot of panic. You got to be chill. You got to be cold as ice and be dialed in.
You got to be cold as ice. You can't be sweating buckets.
Exactly.
You know?
Hence our set and our segment. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, I got you.
Yeah. So I just feel there's a little bit too much panic there.
Okay, one more. Let's talk one more team. We'll talk about Colorado Avalanche. Despite having two players in Nathan MacKinnon and Mikko Rantanen sitting in the top 10 scorers in the entire NHL, team is not currently in a spot.
Well, obviously losing their captain each, Gabriel Landeskog. But you know what, to me? They had an amazing start to the season. I love their first quarter.
Yeah.
And then after that, things just went astray.
Yeah.
After that. So too did their defensive zone coverage.
Yeah.
Their team defensive zone coverage.
Well, I mean, again, tough schedule down the stretch, right? Look at this. At Dallas. That's a huge one tonight. Back-to-back with the Hawks. Back-to-back nights.
Yeah.
Two, not very easy.
That's true.
Golden Knights, Coyotes. You know, the one thing is, though, they're playing teams that they're chasing, so maybe they can,
maybe
get in it. We'll see. Had an accident.
Or two.
I
don't know what's going on there.
All right.
Anybody have any huggies? Can you please send it to the set? If you've got any huggies,
with the leap guard.
Please, get him over here quickly. Please.
Oh, my God, an endorsement deal.
Nah, nothing wrong.
Oh,
come on.